Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents American Presidents in Diplomacy and War, Statecraft, Foreign Policy, and Leadership by Thomas R. Parker. Narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Preface. This book hopes to stimulate thinking about what makes for effective statecraft through a discussion of some of America's iconic presidents, as well as more recent presidents. The goal is to better understand why they were successful or not. Some of the chapters provide an overview of their entire diplomacy, notably that of George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, and Theodore Roosevelt. To provide focus, the chapter on Franklin Roosevelt concentrates on his diplomacy and presidential leadership leading up to the U.S. entry into World War II, and the chapter on Harry Truman analyzes his administration's blunder into provoking Chinese intervention in Korea. There is a wide range of successes and failures to choose from in any period, of course, but the author feels that President Nixon's Middle East diplomacy and President George H.W. Bush's first Gulf War stewardship provide useful lessons about effective statecraft. Conversely, Presidents Carter and Obama, despite their international accomplishments, were tentative and uncertain about military power and diplomacy dealing with security issues. The author also discusses briefly, in the context of diplomatic relations with President Roosevelt, Prime Minister Winston Churchill's audacious decision to bomb the French fleet in 1940 to keep it out of German hands. Conversely, Churchill's prudent decision to avoid committing British troops to Vietnam in the 1950s demonstrates that restraint is as important as assertiveness in diplomacy and war. Such studies of history provide perspectives for students and practitioners of international relations to increase the prospects for success and to avoid being swept up by the passions of the moment. Introduction. In 1953, an American exchange student asked Winston Churchill how one might prepare to meet the challenges of leadership. Churchill replied, "Study history. Study history." To this end, this book is about the statecraft of selected American presidents, as defined by their exercise of diplomatic, military, and economic power. Its goal is to gain insights into why certain presidents were successful in statecraft and why others were less so. We will devote chapters to the diplomacy and wartime leadership of America's most iconic leaders, Presidents George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, Theodore Roosevelt, and Franklin Roosevelt. In doing so, we will compare them to some of their illustrious but less successful contemporaries, notably Presidents Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, and Woodrow Wilson. Statecraft requires the understanding of complex situations, the prudent evaluation of various courses of action, and the ability to learn, adapt, and anticipate, as well as determination. George Washington and his closest advisor, Alexander Hamilton, demonstrated these characteristics, as we will discuss in Chapter 2. During the Revolutionary War, Washington learned from his initial battlefield defeats and adopted a more effective military strategy. Washington and Hamilton used the complicated European balance of power to their own purposes, first siding with France in the 1780s and then remaining neutral in the war between France and England in the 1790s. In contrast, Jefferson and Madison, who championed a more idealistic foreign policy based on solidarity among republics, stumbled into the War of 1812 when they failed to understand the balance of power among England, the United States, and Napoleon's France. Statecraft, as discussed in Chapter 3, may require the ability to combine aggressiveness with caution. President Abraham Lincoln did this when he acted prudently toward Britain and France, both of which supported the Southern cause, while prosecuting a relentless war against the Southern states. As mentioned, successful leaders have the ability to learn, including from their own mistakes. We will discuss in Chapter 4 how, as Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Theodore Roosevelt displayed an initial impulsive nationalism, advocating taking the Philippines from Spain in 1898 without understanding the difficulty of defending the islands from a rising Japan. As president, however, Roosevelt successfully mediated among the European and Asian powers while making America a naval world power for the first time. After World War I, Roosevelt and his close associate, Senator Henry Cabot Lodge, advocated for a political military partnership with Britain and France, as opposed to Woodrow Wilson's more idealistic but less practical League of Nations, with its emphasis on deterring aggression through international public opinion. Franklin Roosevelt's policy toward Europe before the entry of the United States into World War II epitomizes the diplomacy of guile, a sometimes useful element of statecraft. As discussed in Chapter 5, Roosevelt led a dovish American public slowly toward possible participation in World War II. His policy was secretive, devious, and relentless. During the war, he had no compunctions about making moral compromises to further the military effort. Beginning with Chapter 6, we examine historical cases from the post-World War II era. President Harry Truman, with his policy during the Korean War, is an example of a reasonable political leader who made serious mistakes in implementing otherwise well-founded policy, the defense of South Korea. Truman and his distinguished Secretary of State, Dean Acheson, were swept along in the triumphalism of General Douglas MacArthur's bid to unite the entire Korean peninsula after his dramatic military success at Incheon in September 1950. Truman could have avoided the ensuing disaster of Chinese intervention if he had listened to the advice of the more prudent State Department advisor, George Kennan. In Chapter 7, we see the importance of adapting to changing circumstances, as displayed by President Richard Nixon and Secretary of State Henry Kissinger during the 1973 Arab-Israeli War. Nixon and Kissinger first sent arms to Israel to avoid further Israeli military setbacks, and then saved the Egyptian army once the war turned in favor of Israel. The post-war negotiations under Kissinger between Israel and the Arabs also provide lessons on challenging international negotiations. Statecraft may involve the tensions inherent in difficult moral dilemmas and the need to stand up to public pressure. In Chapter 8, we examine the debates within the Carter administration in 1978 about whether to urge the Shah of Iran to crack down on Iranian protesters. Ignoring the advice of his national security advisor, Zbigniew Brzezinski, President Carter held back from doing so, only to blunder subsequently into an unrealistic attempt to liberate U.S. diplomatic personnel in Tehran. Careening from caution to recklessness, Carter also represented a turning point in U.S. foreign policy, initiating a new era in American politics in which candidates with no foreign policy experience became the norm for the first time since the 1920s. President George H.W. Bush, an exception to this new norm, displayed a surer touch in his diplomacy and wartime leadership during the first Gulf War in 1990 and 1991. He did not flinch when his military advisors told him that he would have to commit most of the U.S. military to expelling Iraq from Kuwait, as we see in Chapter 9. A subtle student of international affairs, Bush also embodied determination in successful statecraft. Finally, in Chapter 10, we examine the costs of inexperience and ambivalence toward military power. President Barack Obama brushed off the advice of his more seasoned advisors, who argued for prudence during the explosion of political unrest in the Arab world in 2011. He then stumbled into a counterproductive war in Libya. Wavering between imprudence and excessive caution, he subsequently rejected his advisors' advocacy of a firm response to Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's use of chemical weapons against his own citizens in 2013. Obama's Secretary of Defense, Ash Carter, felt that the president was displaying the naivete and arrogance of a smart but inexperienced leader. All of these case studies attempt to shed light on what makes for successful statecraft by studying the past to help guide the present and the future. An old adage says history does not repeat itself, but it does rhyme. Indeed, Churchill's advice to the student in 1953 also included the following: "In history lie all the secrets of statecraft." Chapter 1. What makes for successful statecraft? Before we turn to historical cases in detail, it would be useful to examine the main components of effective statecraft and provide some brief examples of successes and failures from U.S. and international history. Effective policy begins with understanding complex situations and their broad diplomatic, military, and economic aspects, including the motivations of other countries and their leaders, the stakes involved for one's own country, and public opinion. The Vietnam War provides a useful example of a failure by successive leaders to understand a complex situation. The origins of the war went back to 1947, when President Truman rallied American public support for military and economic aid to Greece and Turkey, and, by extension, to any country threatened by communist outside pressures. This position was buttressed by the famous Foreign Affairs article the same year on containment, the sources of Soviet conduct, by U.S. diplomat George Kennan, who argued that Washington should oppose Soviet expansion. These were laudable as general principles, but as the journalist Walter Lippmann pointed out, the sweeping containment policy risked overcommitting the United States to defending weak regimes where Washington was at a comparative disadvantage. Moreover, Kennan himself qualified the implementation of the containment doctrine by saying that he had never meant that U.S. assistance always required a military component. In short, distinctions needed to be made. Indeed, there were many reasons to be skeptical about the prospects for U.S. success in South Vietnam. Prime Minister Winston Churchill turned aside a U.S. request to help France in Indochina in 1954 and warned U.S. officials of war on the fringes, where the Russians were strong because they could offer assistance and sanctuary to the North Vietnamese and could mobilize the enthusiasm of nationalist and oppressed peoples. Churchill thought it best to defend Southeast Asia at the borders of Malaya, as Britain successfully did in its counterinsurgency campaign in the 1950s. The United States would help Thailand to defend itself in the 1960s. There were other reasons to avoid intervention, in addition to Churchill's warnings about nationalism and the proximity of North Vietnam to Russia and China. Vietnam's terrain, with its lush vegetation, favored the Viet Cong insurgents and worked against U.S. conventional forces with their dependence on air power and artillery. The communist regime also mobilized the entire population of North Vietnam and the Viet Cong guerrillas in South Vietnam. U.S. policymakers also failed to learn from France's military defeats in Vietnam in the 1950s. Overconfident U.S. leaders failed to discuss at length either these comparative disadvantages or the history of the intervention by the French. Finally, Professor Hans Morgenthau of the University of Chicago, one of the pioneering commentators on realism and foreign policy in the mid-20th century, went further by pointing out that the stakes were not that important in South Vietnam. After all, a united communist Vietnam would remain independent of China, given the historical rivalry between the two countries. Indeed, China and Vietnam engaged in a border war within several years of unification in the 1970s, and Vietnam remains an important partner of the United States in the loose coalition of East Asian countries opposed to Chinese expansion. Nor did U.S. policymakers step back from the discussion about a South Vietnam commitment to evaluate the bigger picture of America's comparative position in the Cold War rivalry. A more nuanced assessment might have gone along the following lines. The long struggle between the non-communist and communist worlds would probably involve some losses by both sides. Cuba, for example, would become a Soviet gain, and Yugoslavia a Soviet loss during the early Cold War period. Overall, however, the U.S. position was reasonably solid, given the strong desire of many countries to avoid Soviet domination, including even communist China. One Cold War joke, for example, asked, "Which is the only country surrounded by hostile communist states?" The answer? The Soviet Union. Given the relatively strong geopolitical position of the United States and the internal weaknesses of the Soviet Union, the U.S. could afford to lose a country such as South Vietnam if the prospects for successful intervention at a reasonable cost were poor. In short, U.S. leaders failed to come to grips with the many reasons why the commitment to support South Vietnam was not vital and would probably turn out poorly. The importance of prudence. The 18th-century British parliamentarian Edmund Burke called prudence the god of this lower world. Prudence takes the understanding of complexity and relates it to actual policy decisions about what the United States might or might not do. What are the pros and cons of the various policy options? Their chances of success? What might be the costs if a given policy is successful? What are the various policy traps that should be avoided? Prudent policymaking depends on the ability to examine and implement policy options as objectively and dispassionately as possible, and to minimize wishful thinking, willfulness, and risk aversion. Abraham Lincoln, for example, was deliberative in his approach to political and military options. According to Charles Dana, Lincoln's assistant, the president had not freakish notions that things were so, or might be so, when they were not so. All this thinking and reasoning, all his mind, in short, was based continually upon actual facts, and upon facts which, as I said, he saw the essence. Lincoln knew there were too many imponderables to forecast the outcomes of battles, and he never assumed that the North would win the Civil War. He was certain, however, that it would lose if it followed the strategy of General George McClellan, who was excessively fearful about engaging with Lee's army. Lincoln, therefore, made a bold move in removing McClellan, despite the general's popularity with Union troops. McClellan's risk-averse mentality is not rare among military and political leaders. In the First Gulf War, when U.S. military planners, most of whom were initially opposed to using military force, provided President George H.W. Bush with an unenthusiastic briefing about their cautious war plans, Deputy National Security Advisor Robert Gates said it reminded him of McClellan. Bush did not remove those military planners, but he did tell them to come back with a more aggressive plan. Conversely, political leaders sometimes fall prey to the wishful thinking born of overconfidence. Their attitude usually reflects some combination of their natural optimism, the impact of recent successes, and the political temper of their time. President George W. Bush fell into this trap regarding Afghanistan and Iraq in the early 2000s. Another dimension of prudence is the imperative to match means, the appropriate ways of applying them, and ends. Lippmann expressed this with his well-known formulation, "Without the controlling principles that the nation must maintain its objectives and its power in equilibrium, its purposes within its means, and its means equal to its purposes, its commitments related to its resources, and its recourses to its commitments, it is impossible to think at all about foreign affairs." President Franklin Roosevelt illustrated this judicious approach when he rejected the advice of his senior military leaders to consider invading France in 1942 and 1943. Instead, he accepted Churchill's counsel to postpone an invasion of France until the Allies had gained aerial and maritime superiority over Germany, as they did by 1944. Roosevelt and Churchill agreed to fight in the less demanding theater of North Africa and Sicily until then. Roosevelt's policy leading up to World War II also demonstrates that guile sometimes has its place in statecraft, although U.S. politicians and the general public have generally frowned on its use. American diplomats, for example, stormed out of Paris in 1798 when French Foreign Minister Maurice du Talleyrand asked for a bribe before discussing their concerns about French harassment of American shipping in the XYZ affair. Likewise, few U.S. political figures would make Henry Kissinger's reported joke about circumventing the congressionally mandated arms embargo against Turkey for its invasion of Cyprus in 1974. The illegal we do immediately. The unconstitutional takes a little longer. Yet guile has its place in diplomacy and war. Churchill wrote that in wartime, truth is so precious that it should be attended by a bodyguard of lies. Similarly, Franklin Roosevelt said, "I am perfectly willing to mislead and tell untruths to the public if it will help win the war." Moreover, guile does not always mean deceit. It can simply involve cunning. Lincoln, for example, outmaneuvered his opponents at the beginning of the American Civil War at the Union Fort Sumter in Charleston, South Carolina. The fort was running out of supplies soon after Lincoln took office, and most of his cabinet members recommended withdrawing U.S. forces before they were forced to capitulate. Lincoln, however, saw the dire situation as an opportunity to induce the South to fire the first shots of the Civil War. He informed Confederate leaders, therefore, that Washington would resupply the fort with provisions, but no additional personnel or arms. This threat of no more personnel was meant to appeal to the states where slavery was legal, notably Kentucky and Maryland, but which were considering staying in the Union. The spirited but doomed defense of the fort was designed to appeal to the North. The Southerners fell into the trap of firing first, and Northerners volunteered for military service by the thousands. One of the most remarkable examples of deception in diplomacy involved Talleyrand's attempts to head off Napoleon's disastrous invasion of Russia. When the French emperor met Russian Emperor Alexander I in 1808, Talleyrand decided to meet secretly with the Tsar. First, Talleyrand would recommend to Napoleon what to say to the Tsar. Talleyrand would then meet Alexander in secret to tell him what Napoleon was going to say and suggest to the Tsar what he should say to Napoleon in return. It was a tour de force of deceit that many in France considered treasonous, but it was for a just cause. Groupthink. In addition to avoiding excessive caution or overconfidence, a prudent political leader should be aware of other dangerous traps. Students of statecraft have often warned about the dangers of groupthink, when the dynamics of group cohesion discourage a thorough airing of various options. Historians have criticized President John F. Kennedy for approaching the Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba with this mindset, in contrast to his thoughtful handling of the Cuban Missile Crisis, during which he sought out various points of view. The role of public opinion and the political ambience. Any foreign policy must have some basic level of support from public opinion, or at least acquiescence, for it to succeed long term. At best, a committed president can go against public opinion if the price and risk are not too high. President Ronald Reagan, for example, went against the prevailing isolationist mood when he supported the Salvadoran government with U.S. trainers against a communist insurgency in the 1980s. As we shall learn with Franklin Roosevelt, true intentions can also be disguised until the national mood changes in light of new circumstances. At the same time, leaders must avoid the mistake of pursuing foolish policies to placate public opinion. At some point, they are likely to pay a price. Despite his skepticism, President Kennedy approved the Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba for fear of Republican criticism for not taking action against Cuban leader Fidel Castro. Political leaders must also try to avoid being swayed by the ambient political atmosphere, often in reaction to the most recent international events, be they positive or negative. George W. Bush and most of his senior advisors were overly influenced by the relatively easy military victories in Kuwait and the Balkans in the 1990s and the initial success of Afghanistan in 2001. Iraq would be the same, they thought, incorrectly. In contrast, Presidents Carter and Obama, as we shall learn, tended to act with excessive caution during security challenges, in part because of the failure of the Vietnam War and the difficult conflicts in Afghanistan and Iraq. The slippery slope, or mission creep. Prudence requires an awareness of the dangers of how commitments can slide from modest engagements to unintended and overly ambitious ones. President Reagan began what he considered a modest U.S. troop commitment in Lebanon in 1982 to escort the Palestine Liberation Front's combatants out of Beirut in order to end the Israeli siege there. Once that was accomplished, he withdrew U.S. troops only to send them back to protect Palestinian civilians after massacres at several refugee camps. This mission then morphed into a more ambitious commitment to side with the Lebanese government against Hezbollah, the radical Shia organization. Hezbollah suicide bombers inflicted hundreds of casualties on several U.S. Marine barracks, thereby driving the United States out of Lebanon. Iraqi President Saddam Hussein drew the lesson that Americans would not tolerate casualties as part of his calculation in invading Kuwait in 1990. The U.S. setback in Somalia in the early 1990s went through a somewhat similar evolution from a modest initial commitment to a more ambitious and risky one. The dangers of the cautious middle path. While prudence avoids unnecessary risk, this does not mean that a prudent leader should always seek a cautious middle path that splits the difference between options. Such a path sometimes appears superficially appealing, but can cause leaders to avoid tough but necessary decisions. When, for example, Italian dictator Benito Mussolini invaded Ethiopia in 1935, British and French leaders faced a dilemma. On the one hand, they could have opted for a forceful military move, such as closing the Suez Canal to Italy. On the other hand, Mussolini was still wary of Hitler's expansionist plans in the mid-1930s, and the British and the French might have acquiesced to Italy's invasion in an attempt to form an anti-German front. Instead, Britain and the League of Nations agreed on a half-hearted international oil embargo against Italy. This created an impression of weakness while pushing Italy into an alliance with Germany. Better to have either responded forcefully, as Churchill advised when he was a member of Parliament, or accept the invasion, as the French government privately counseled. The middle path failed on all accounts. Losing interest in policies. President Joseph Biden's withdrawal from Afghanistan in 2021 provides an excellent example of this danger. Reasonable observers could have differed over the president's decision to withdraw all U.S. military forces in the spring of 2021 to end the trickle of casualties and to focus on other foreign policy priorities. However, once he made the decision to withdraw, he and his senior advisors lost their focus on the country. U.S. military commanders reasoned that if the president was uninterested, they might as well leave Afghanistan as quickly as possible to minimize military casualties. Thus, U.S. military forces withdrew before the total withdrawal of U.S. citizens and friendly Afghans, thereby causing the notorious chaos at the Kabul airport and the decision to send back U.S. military forces. Ironically, the early withdrawal may have resulted in more military casualties than would have been the case if the military had remained until all civilians were evacuated. Thoughtful leaders, therefore, must monitor important commitments even as they are being brought to an end. Failure of imagination. Political leaders may stumble badly when they fail to consider all relevant policy options. For example, after Osama bin Laden and al-Qaeda attacked U.S. embassies in East Africa in 1998, the Clinton administration debated whether to respond with cruise missile attacks lasting only several hours against the al-Qaeda camps, or whether to attack them periodically. No one considered focusing the response against Al-Qaeda's Taliban hosts. Cruise missile attacks were never going to dissuade bin Laden from attacking U.S. targets. But the Taliban had something to lose, and U.S. leaders could have told them either to stop bin Laden from attacking U.S. targets or be prepared to see much of Afghanistan's infrastructure destroyed. To drive home the point, the U.S. could have destroyed a target such as the Kandahar airport, striking at night to avoid civilian casualties. Another missed opportunity to debate all relevant options occurred when the George W. Bush administration failed to consider the possibility of conducting periodic airstrikes on suspected Iraqi nuclear and biological weapons facilities instead of a large ground invasion. A careful evaluation of this option might have concluded that any nuclear program probably could be contained through airstrikes, given the large scope of such programs. Since biological programs are smaller and easier to hide, a decision to launch a ground invasion may have come down to the scope of the biological weapons threat. Reasonable advisors might have differed over the best response, but the option of airstrikes was never considered because the administration was carried away by the sense of vulnerability after the 9/11 attacks and by hubris after the early success against the Taliban in Afghanistan. George W. Bush and Obama, along with most of their advisors, also failed to consider the full array of policy options regarding Afghanistan. Both tried to gain control over the entire country. U.S. troops reached their peak at about 100,000 under Obama, which in fact comprised several very different regions. The Turkic and Tajik/Iranian peoples in northern and western Afghanistan were largely opposed to the Taliban. In contrast, the Pashtun peoples of southern and eastern Afghanistan were friendlier to the Taliban, who could take advantage of mountainous terrain and sanctuaries in Pakistan. Neither Bush nor Obama considered focusing the U.S. military effort on securing military bases around Kabul and in the north and west rather than in the entire country. These would have served as bases to search for and attack Al-Qaeda and bin Laden in Pakistan. Vice President Biden was the only voice advocating for something along these lines during the Obama administration. Another form of a failure of imagination relates to the advice that senior foreign policy advisors provide to the president. Advisors discuss and debate policies among themselves and seek to do so in a coolly detached and analytical manner. However, they should remember that a president must explain and defend the policy before the nation and the world. For example, before the North Korean invasion of South Korea in 1950, President Truman's military advisors advocated abandoning South Korea. They failed to imagine how Truman might respond to an actual invasion. Understanding one's own side is as important as understanding the adversary. To summarize, prudent action requires a rigorous weighing of all the pros and cons of various courses of action before a policy commitment is decided upon and implemented, as well as an awareness of the range of policy traps. As Hans Morgenthau wrote, "Realism, then, considers prudence, the weighing of the consequences of alternative political actions, to be the supreme virtue in politics." The realm of action, the imperative of determination. Once policies are decided upon, particularly those involving military force, understanding complexity and exercising prudence remain essential, but other characteristics of statecraft also come into play. If prudence dominates intelligent policy discussions about various courses of action, determination is needed to implement decisions unwaveringly. Determination does not guarantee success, but its absence will result in failure. As Secretary of State Kissinger wrote about the successful threat of intervention by U.S. and Israeli military forces to force the Syrian army to withdraw from northern Jordan, which it had invaded in the 1970s, a leader must choose carefully and thoughtfully the issues over which to face confrontation. He should do so only for major objectives. Once he is committed, however, his obligation is to end the confrontation rapidly. For this, he must convey implacability. More concisely, Napoleon reportedly said, "If you begin to take Vienna, take Vienna." The first Israeli prime minister, David Ben-Gurion, conveyed implacability. With the outbreak of the First Arab-Israeli War in May 1948, all four Jewish militia forces pledged to merge into one organization, the Israeli Defense Forces. However, the mainstream Haganah and its Palmach units remained rivals with the smaller and more militant Irgun Zvi Leumi, IZL, headed by Menachem Begin. In June 1948, the IZL organized a large shipment of arms and men from Europe to Israel on the Altalena with the intention of keeping most, if not all, of the arms for its own forces. Ben-Gurion insisted that all the arms be sent to the new centralized Israeli Defense Forces command and ordered Palmach units under the command of Yitzhak Rabin to open fire on the ship as it approached Tel Aviv, resulting in the deaths of 18 IZL combatants. Ben-Gurion later said that when the Jews finally built the Third Temple, the first and second having been destroyed by the Babylonians and Romans, respectively, the holy cannon that sank the Altalena would find its place at the side of the altar. Perhaps the most striking example of audacity was Churchill's decision to bomb the French fleet in North Africa in July 1940. Once Germany and France had signed an armistice ending hostilities, Churchill dreaded that Berlin would force Paris into turning over its navy to Germany. He pleaded with the French to unite their naval forces with the British navy, send them to the French West Indies, or sabotage them. When the French refused, Churchill ordered a naval and air attack on the French fleet in North Africa that killed over 1,000 French sailors. We will study further this example from British history of implacable determination in our chapter on President Franklin Roosevelt. Combining intellect with action, the need to learn, to adapt, and to anticipate. Along with single-minded focus, effective statecraft also requires the ability to learn, to adapt, and to anticipate. As noted, George Washington and Theodore Roosevelt learned from early mistakes, and Secretary of State Henry Kissinger adapted U.S. policy to changing circumstances during the 1973 Arab-Israeli War. On the other hand, we shall learn that during the wars between Britain and France, Thomas Jefferson and James Madison failed to anticipate the counterproductive dangers of their own aggressive policies against British maritime harassment. Adapting to changing circumstances involves grappling with the complexity of new realities. Many observers thought the invasion of Iraq in 2003 was a mistake. However, once it began, a strong case could also be made for seeing it through, as President George W. Bush did in making his unpopular but successful 2006 decision to send additional troops to Iraq. Similarly, President Obama's opposition to the Iraq War while he was a U.S. senator may have been justified, but his withdrawal of all U.S. forces from Iraq in 2012 contributed to the rise of the Islamic State. Similarly, President Dwight Eisenhower may have been right to oppose British and French military intervention in Egypt in 1956. However, it was arguably a mistake to force Britain and France to desist once the war started, because Egyptian President Gamal Abdel Nasser would go on to falsely claim that he had defeated the British and French in battle. The Egyptian people fell for the ruse, and an emboldened Nasser blundered into a disastrous defeat by Israel in 1967. Adaptability also requires sometimes reconsidering one's partners and one's adversaries. Perhaps the United States should have considered supporting the secular communist government of Najibullah in Kabul once the Soviets withdrew from Afghanistan in 1989. While pro-Soviet, he would have been less of a threat than the Taliban, which Pakistan helped put in power in 1996. Finally, Leaders must acknowledge when their policies are not succeeding and adapt to reality. Presidents Reagan and Clinton pulled out of Lebanon and Somalia, respectively, without too much agonizing, because U.S. interests were relatively limited and U.S. losses were modest in number. In contrast, President Nixon and Secretary of State Kissinger pursued the prospects of an independent South Vietnam over 4 years in the hopes of defending national credibility and avoiding depredations of victorious communist movements, such as the Cambodian mass exterminations. However, preventing communist victories was unlikely, given declining American domestic support and North Vietnam's determination and support from China and Russia. Moreover, the longer the United States stayed in South Vietnam, the stronger the anti-intervention reaction of the U.S. public. American troops arguably should have withdrawn more quickly, but still in an orderly fashion. Thus, in statecraft, even determination, the twin brother of prudence, must recognize its limits. Interests and ideals. Prudent leaders have tended to be wary of moralism and foreign policy, and have been willing to make moral compromises for larger purposes. Franklin Roosevelt summed up his approach to foreign policy with a Balkan proverb: "My children, you are permitted in time of great danger to walk with the devil until you have crossed the bridge." So he told the press privately to justify working with morally compromised individuals in the French Vichy government to help the World War II effort in North Africa. Prudent leaders also tend to avoid making the promotion of democracy a major feature of foreign policy for several reasons. Stable democracies usually require a minimum economic and social foundation. In their absence, authoritarian leaders can use unstable conditions to take power through ostensibly democratic elections, as evidenced by Hitler in the 1930s, Venezuelan President Hugo Chavez in 1999, Hamas in the Gaza Strip in 2007, and the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt in 2013. Sometimes there are also trade-offs regarding unstable democracies. The democratic regime that emerged briefly in Tunisia after the Arab protest movements in 2011 was less able to control terrorism than its autocratic predecessor. Moreover, supporting democratic movements requires an involvement in the internal affairs of countries that may create its own problems. As laudable as U.S. attempts have been to support democratic forces in Russia, they probably contributed to President Vladimir Putin's decision to disrupt the 2016 U.S. election, and may actually have hurt the opposition movement inside Russia, given the general antipathy to the United States there. Similarly, the U.S. government's high-profile support for anti-Russian political forces in Ukraine during the Bush and the Obama administrations probably factored into Putin's decision to invade Ukraine in 2014 and 2022. Prudent leaders should also be wary of humanitarian intervention. The United States has limited military and political capital to spend internationally, and it should be saved for major challenges to U.S. interests. Moreover, humanitarian intervention often proves ineffective because the U.S. public is not willing to support sustained intervention if no visible interests are at stake, as was the case in Lebanon in the early 1980s. Similarly, Kissinger warned about the dangers of the slippery slope in Somalia in the early 1990s before American and other foreign troops were murdered and mutilated. He foresaw that Washington would work with some armed groups, thereby alienating others, as occurred when the warlord Muhammad Idid turned against international forces. Finally, not all cultures share the Western enthusiasm for pluralism and democratic elections, at least for the time being. Most rural Chinese seem to prefer autocrats and strongmen to democratic pluralism. A similar dynamic appears to be at play in the small towns and rural areas of Russia. Moreover, even when peoples of foreign countries find some elements of democracy and freedom attractive, nationalism, and religious movements usually have stronger appeal by fostering a sense of belonging and sometimes rejection of the outside culture. Let us now turn to the foreign policies of some of America's most illustrious past presidents and some of its more recent ones. As Churchill counseled, under close analysis, history can help educate political leaders and engaged citizens. And, as the 19th century German Chancellor Otto von Bismarck reportedly said, "A fool learns from his mistakes. A wise man learns from the mistakes of others." Chapter 2. Washington, Hamilton, Jefferson, and Madison. The diplomacy of realism versus the diplomacy of ideology and uncertainty. George Washington was not a warm, sentimental man. He was courteous, but maintained a strong reserve. Once his colleague, Governor Morris, bet his friends that he could gently place his arm on Washington's shoulder in a cheery greeting. Washington gave him a withering look, and Morris told his friends afterward it was the last time he, or anyone else, would do that. Washington was hard on those who surrounded him. He once criticized Alexander Hamilton for being late for a meeting, leading Hamilton to submit his resignation, which Washington rejected. The president refused his officers' pleas to execute Major John Andre, who had been working with General Benedict Arnold to surrender the ford at West Point to the British by a firing squad instead of hanging him as a common spy. While hard on others, he was also demanding of himself. He drove himself relentlessly during the Revolutionary Wars, never benefiting from better material conditions than his men, including during the miserable winter at Valley Forge. Although Washington had an explosive temper, his rage would pass and he would return to the subject under discussion. At times excessively sensitive to criticism, he never forgot slights, but would not allow them to determine his actions. Above all, Washington was a prudent man. Jefferson said it best. Perhaps the strongest feature of his character was prudence, never acting until every circumstance, every consideration was maturely weighed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.